Hello, my dear students. How are you? Hope you are well. This is Manjura Mustafa, assistant professor of English. Today I am going to conduct a class with honors second year students, and my targeted class is The Rhyme of the Ancient Mariner, Part 1, Study and Analysis. So, my dear student, let us progress the poem. Part 1. It is an ancient mariner, and he stoppeth one of three by thy long grey beard and glittering eye. Now wherefore stoppest thou me? The first very line, my dear students, look at the first very, very first line of the poem. The very first line of the poem introduces us with the protagonist or main character, that means the ancient mariner. Why he is ancient? He is ancient not because of his old age, but he is aged or he is old, but he is ancient because he carries experience of his sea voyage. So he is an experienced person. For that reason, like ancient city, like ancient town, he also bears the testimony of some story. And he stopped one of three. He stops one of three Barry's guests by thy long grey beard and glittering eye. Now where? For stoppest thou me, within inverted comma. So this next two lines are from the Mary's guests. He is very much annoyed, and he gives us the appearance or description of the appearance of the ancient mariner. And one thing I wanna say, that is this poem, as it is a lyrical ballad, you look at the very starting of the poem, it has very abrupt starting. The poem starts very dramatically. The poem starts without any introduction or without any preface. Just it starts suddenly. It is an ancient mariner. Here also we get the information or description of the ancient mariner. He has long beard and also glittering eye. And one point, my students, this is very much unusual, because when with the age or with the progress of time, sharpness of the eyes, our eyes becomes dim. But this is very unusual. Though the ancient mariner is very aged, his eyes is very glittering. The bridegroom's drawer are opened wide, and I am next of kin. The guests are met, the feast is set. Mayst hear the maiden. He holds him with his skinny hand. There was a ship. Hold off and hand me grey beard loon. Ipsoon his hand dropped he. The ancient mariner holds or detains the marriage guest from participating the marriage feast by holding his hand, and he starts the story in a very dramatic way. Just there was a ship in a very dramatic way. He starts his story, he starts telling his story, and this dramatic way of telling his story gives the readers or the marriage guest makes interested to listen to his story. And next thing is that when the Marius guest in his mind, he thinks that and also rebukes the ancient mariner that hold off, unhand me, then if soon his hand drops me. The ancient mariner soon, then and then the ancient mariner unholds his hand. So as though he is a mind reader, as though the ancient mariner is a mind's reader. The fourth stanza is very important, and also I wanna put emphasis on the fourth stanza. He holds him with his glittering eye. The wedding guest stood still and listens like a 3 years child. The mariner hath his will. The mariner cast a hypnotic spell on the wedding guest. That is, instead of holding him by his hand, the mariner now holds him with his glittering eye. And the wedding guest, being hypnotized, cannot but hear his story, cannot but listen his story. He is compelled to listen the story. That means the ancient mariner is successful to exercise his hypnotic power over the marriage guest. And for that reason, the marriage guest doesn't have any other way but to listen the story of the ancient mariner helplessly like a three years child. Next, the ship was cheered and the harbor cleared. Merrily did we drop below the curve, below the hill, below the lighthouse top. The ship crossed the harbor and very quickly and entered the main sea waters. The sun came up upon the lift. Out of the sea came he, and he shone bright, and on the right went down into the sea. The ship was sailing toward the south, and finally they reached to the equator. How the ship was sailing towards the south, from the story of the ancient mariner, he is giving the direction. When the sun rises from the left side, that means the ship is sailing towards the southward. And in these stanzas, we find various uses of archaic words. Coleridge uses lots of archaic words because of giving the story an interesting power. That means he has love for the past. This is one of the elements of romanticism. From the very beginning, we say stop it means stops. Wherefore stoppest thou means you. Then here we find kirk means church. Next, the sun higher and higher every day till over the mast and noon. The wedding guest here beat his breast, for he heard the loud basson. The bride hath passed into the hall, red as a rose is she, nodding their heads before her goes the merry minstrelly. Red as a rose is she, the bride has been compared with a red rose. This is a use of simile. she is as beautiful as a red rose. The wedding guest, he beat his breast, yet he cannot choose but hear, and thus spake on that ancient mariner, the bright-eyed mariner. This is a lyrical ballad, and in a lyrical ballad we have already learned that we will find repetition of stanzas, some stanzas or repetition of lines. Look at the repetition of lines. The bright-eyed mariner, these lines has been repeated twice. And now the south blast came, and he was tyrannous and strong. He struck with his overtaking wings and chased us south alone. Suddenly strong sea storm rose. Suddenly strong sea storm rose. And the storm has been personified here. The storm has been personified here. The storm personified as a huge and swift bird. The storm has been compared as a swift and huge bird here. As if it is a swift bird of prey, or a winged monster we chased the ship. The ship was forcibly driven by the storm towards the south pole, and the wind has been treated here as he. So the wind has been personified here, uses the personification. And the mariner carries on speaking the story. The cold was really unbearable. With stopping masts and dipping prow, as who pursued with yell and blow, still treads and shadow of his foe, and forward bends his head, the ship drove fast, loud roared the blast, and southward we fled. And now there came both mist and snow, and it grew wondrous cold, and ice mast high came floating by as green as emerald. So the mariner carrying on speaking the story, the cold was really unbearable. Icebergs was as high as the mast of the ship, and the icebergs were floating here and there in the sea, and the greenish reflection of the sea makes the icebergs look like emerald. The greenness of the ocean, actually the greenness of the ocean reflected to the iceberg, and for that reason the icebergs have become green as emerald. The ice was the extent of ice. The ice was here, the ice was there, the ice was all around. It cracked and growled and roared and howled like noises in a shunt. The ship becomes trapped by ice. The extent of ice, all around the ship has been displaced with the repetition of the words like ice, here, there, and all around. The words cracked and growled and roared and howled. Collectively convey the sounds they produce. They are onomatopoeic words. Here, Coleridge has, in a very perfect way, uses the figures of speech onomatopoeia. Onomatopoeia is the sound of the words conveying their sense. At length did cross an albatross. Through the fog it came as if it had been a Christian soul. We hailed it in God's name. After a considerable time, an albatross came through the fog. Albatross is a large sea bug. Albatross is an oceanic bird, mainly seen in the Pacific and Southern Ocean. And this albatross plays a vital role in this poem. The mariners considers and compares the albatross with Christian soul. They welcomed it in God's name. It ate the food it never had ate, and round it flew. The eyes did split with a thunder fit. The helmsman stared as thorough. The albatross made the eyes break apart, allowing the captain to steer out the icy region. And a good south wind sprang up behind. The albatross did follow, and every day for food or play came to the mariner's hollow. So the albatross, whenever the mariners because the albatross, it came near the mariners, and they offered the albatross food and drink, and for that reason the albatross has become an intimate friend, or there is a close bonding or relationship with the albatross with the mariners. In mist or cloud or master shroud, it passed for vesper night. Vesper means evening prayer. So it came nine evening prayer, that means 9 days. Whilst all the night through fog smoke white glimmered the white moonshine. So there is a description of nature. God save the ancient mariner from the fiends that plague thee thus. Why lookest thou so? With my crossbow I shot the albatross. So this is the last stanza of the poem, The Rhyme of the Ancient Mariner, part 1. And the marriage guest gives the description of the appearance of the ancient mariner. Suddenly his face becomes full of agony and craziness, as if any fiends has cursed him. And the ancient mariner announces that without any reason, wantonly, whimsically, without no reason, with his crossbow, he killed the innocent bird, that means the big sea bird which summons good wind for them. And my dear students, killing of albatross must be symbolic, and killing of the bird without any reason, killing of the bird whimsically, this is one thing symbolic. And for killing the bird, what will happen next, we will enjoy in next part. But before going to next part, let us explain something. This poem, The Rhyme of the Ancient Mariner, and the first part of the poem is exuberance with the treatment of romanticism. Coleridge very perfectly handled the uses of romantic elements. Nature plays a pivotal role in both the poem and in romanticism. The sea, the sky, the sun, the breeze, the storm, the icy ocean, the iceberg, mist, the moon, albatross, all illustrate aspects of nature, one of the main themes of romanticism. The appearance of the albatross in the land where living things are scarce appears magical or supernatural. Also, the horrifying description of nature, description of the appearance of the ancient mariner, his long gray beard, his glittering eyes, all these aspects has supernatural elements or supernatural tasks. We also find some mystic numbers here. Three marriage guests, number three, then nine vespers, three, seven, nine, five. These are mystic numbers which also throws its supernatural shadows upon the poem. And the poem is pregnant with the use of sensuousness. We find all types of sensuousness: visual, auditory, olfactory, the oceanic bird, the sun, the moon, the icebergs, the greenish icebergs, the vast sea, the vast sky, and also the onomatopoeic words. All this carries sensuousness to the poem. And another element of romanticism is the use of conversational language. We find here dialogues in the poem, and also love for the past or medievalism or archaic words, as I have said before. And this poem is a lyrical ballad. It starts abruptly, suddenly, and various dramatic turn of the story we also find, and repetition of some specific lines or specific stanzas also there, and quatrains or stanzas. The rhyming skill in a ballad is A, B, C, B. We also find this rhyming in this poem rhyming, and it has also musical elements. Musical, it can be sung. Rhyme and rhythm also in this poem. So my dear students, I hope you will enjoy this poem, and we will enjoy the part 2 in our next class, and from there thank you very much. Stay safe, stay sound.